My emails and comment section are inundated from time to time with requests for an opinion on matters sadly not related to the rhesus monkeys I am following, but more about general and sometimes very specific issues regarding long-tailed macaques.
Oh no!
I suppose it is to do with the lack of drama and strange happenings on my side, which I actually are grateful about. I have decided to answer some of the more frequent and pressing questions with the best of my knowledge, and if I cannot, I would try to look it up and present it without the jargon in a more readily accessible form. Are you ready? Let's start.
Yeah.
First one. I cannot really answer that from my experience, as the monkeys I follow are rhesus. But most studies have shown them to have a decent survival rate in the wild. One paper that is mostly quoted for long-tailed macaques is one by Van Noordwijk and Van Schaik, published in 1999 in the journal Primates. So in general, in the first year of life, a baby long-tailed has more than an 80% survival rate. This dropped to 68% by the year of 4, presumably due to its increased exposure to other risks in life as it becomes more independent, but is still lacking the necessary experience and skills to deal with or to avoid them. This survival rate probably also holds true for rhesus macaques in the wild too. In my 3 years following Bossy's troop, I have observed the followings. In 2016 there were 9 births, 7 have survived to date. The 2 missing and presumed dead were Lanley and Bossy Jr. In 2017 there were 11 births and they are all still with us as we speak. In 2018 there were 13 births so far, all but one, baby Lacey, have made it. So the infant mortality rate, at least in the first year of life, is between 0% to about 22%, as we have seen so far. So with moderate food supplement by various feeders, almost all rhesus macaque babies in Monkey Hill survive, and with food actually handed to them on a plate in the grounds of Angkor day in and day out all year round since filming began in the summer of 2016, the survival rate there for long-tailed macaque babies ought to be higher still than the quoted 80%. This makes sense, as the biggest killers in the wild for baby macaques are malnutrition, diseases and accidents.
Oh no!
Feeding makes the single biggest killer, malnutrition irrelevant. Adequate nutrition also reduces the chance of an infant catching and succumbing to various diseases. Feeding also lessens the risks of many accidents associated with foraging for both mothers and infants, but of course it does not prevent an accident from happening altogether. In fact, all the babies that went missing so far in Bossy's troop were all healthy, lively babies prior to their disappearances. I think the cause of death for Lanley, daughter of Lancy, born in 2016, was a fatal fall. The others I have really no idea, but falls are high on my list given that most babies who died did so at around the age of 6 months, which is about the age when they are likely to be given a freer rein by their mothers. Lastly, feeding also has its inherent risk, and I suspect Bossy Jr.'s death was directly or indirectly related to it. When feeding is combined with filming for a prolonged period of time alongside a busy road, it is almost the most deadly, as the process distracts a mother while at the same time desensitize a baby too early to the traffic, as we have witnessed in the grounds of Angkor, as no less than 7 babies were killed on that busy road inside the Gate of Bayan ruins in Angkor in the summer of 2017, and it is without surprise that all the babies killed there were those who were named, followed and filmed day in and day out by the road. Roadkill of babies are rare, and I hope people will take heed to the dangers of feeding and filming along any busy road. So in summary, the natural infant mortality rate in the wild is low for long-tailed macaques and likely so too for rhesus, about 20% in the first year of life, which is substantially reduced if feeding occurs.
Oops!
Okay, let's begin with next question. This one has been popping up quite frequently recently. Indeed, you are not the first one to sound the alarm. A few people have asked me in the emails and recently two more in the comments section with questions related to the recent spate of monkeys which died shortly after labor with what seemed to be incomplete evacuation of placenta as the cause. Indeed, retained placenta is a medical emergency in humans as it could cause life-threatening hemorrhage and a woman could die if the condition is not rectified. Fortunately, retained placenta as a complication of vaginal delivery is a rare condition in humans, with between 1 to 3% of women affected by this life-threatening condition. Risk factors in humans for these complications are chiefly stillbirth, old age of the mother, previous surgery of the uterus, a previous history of the same condition, premature delivery and a long, protracted and difficult labor. Other factors like diabetes and obesity could also play a minor part too. I don't have any hands-on experience with retained placenta in humans as I have never seen one in my life so far. Given that I have been following a troop of 40-plus rhesus monkeys, most of them females, and given that there have been 33 live births in this troop over the last 3 years, perhaps I should be more aware of this condition in non-human primates, one probably would say. Nope, I am afraid, and not one of those mothers have appeared to have anything remotely resembling even a cord dangling between their legs I have seen so far, and even less of a death. Well, actually, there have been no death of any mother at all so far, touch wood. Perhaps retained placentas are also rare in non-human primates as well. Oh well, in a paper published by Bauer and Harrison in 2016 in the journal Comparative Medicine, it seems to confirm this general observation too, and more, there are some interesting differences in the risk factors for and outcomes of the condition between humans and macaques too. Let's find out. Let's have a bit on the background first. The authors examined the birthing records of three different species of non-human primates: baboons, long-tailed and rhesus, kept at the Southwest National Primate Research Center in Texas over a period of between 10 to 15 years between 1999 to 2015. The sample size is large, as they were taken from a breeding colony of about 2,000 baboons, 1,000 long-tailed macaques and 500 rhesus respectively. The data involved close to 5,900 births of baboons and 2,000 of long-tailed and 900 of rhesus over that period of time. Let's see what they have found. 1. Retained placentas are also rare in non-human primates. There were only 158 cases in baboons, 64 cases in long-tailed and only 9 cases in rhesus over 10 to 15 years. So the chance of it ever occurring in these three species closely mirrors that of humans, between 1 to 3% again. 2. Most cases of retained placenta resolve spontaneously in these three species. It takes on average 10 days for baboons, 5 days for long-tailed and 8 days for rhesus to evacuate the placenta completely. 3. A retained placenta is not a medical emergency in non-human primates, as hemorrhage is not a problem in these animals. In fact, none of the cases were associated with any hemorrhage at all. 4. A retained placenta in non-human primates rarely kills as a result, with only 10 deaths in baboons, 5 in long-tailed and none whatsoever in rhesus in the study. How they died, however, are not clearly indicated in the study, but reading between the lines, it seems some were euthanized as they had had too many stillbirths in the past and were not deemed suitable to remain reproductive in a breeding colony. So that makes the overall mortality rate for the condition in long-tailed macaques less than 8% and for baboons, about 6%. 5. Most risk factors identified in humans are not as clearly applicable in the cases of non-human primates. Obesity doesn't increase the risk, though advanced age does predispose one to have the condition, as does having 3 or more births before. However, stillbirth is the single most consistent risk factor for retained placenta occurring naturally in non-human primates. 6. Non-human primates could take, in the longest case, 2 months to evacuate an entire placenta, but on average most with the condition will resolve by themselves in 7 days. Most of them had no problem to continue to care and to nurse their own babies while still being affected by this condition. Most experienced no complication nor any long-term consequences from it, and most would breed successfully again subsequently. So in summary, retained placentas are rare in non-human primates too. Most will resolve spontaneously over a week or so, and very rarely will they kill, and if they do, death doesn't occur immediately, as non-human primates do not seem to suffer from bleeding in this condition, and death, if it ever happens, would probably be related to complications directly or indirectly related to the condition, developing probably over many days or even weeks. If death occurs shortly following a live birth of a healthy baby, this fact alone would strongly contradict a retained placenta as a cause. Something else is going on instead that is killing the mother, and the retained placenta is just a red herring, as the mother died before she could expel the placenta, which could sometimes take between hours to days to complete the process. I am not going to watch the videos, as they always follow the same predictable scenario: an animal suddenly becoming ill or injured, someone coming to the rescue after much pleading from viewers in a long drawn-out process, and the predictable outcome of a distressed baby or infant being the focus of a few dozens videos daily, all overladen with 4 or 5 adverts and across at least a dozen channels, some old and some new each time. Macaques are hardy animals, they heal many injuries that could kill or debilitate us humans, they could take many naturally occurring toxins that would kill us. They are in many ways superior to us immunologically, physiologically, and biochemically. One rarely sees a dead adult macaque in the wild, and even rarer and stranger, one that appeared to be perfectly healthy shortly beforehand. We didn't see any retained placenta nor any death from it in the first 18 months when filming first began, with even more unhealthy and elderly females giving birth, some even with stillbirth one after another in the grounds of Angkor, and none of those babies born had had that many injuries as we are seeing now. What is happening in Angkor and elsewhere? Why has mortality and morbidity rate suddenly shot up all of a sudden? If this trend continues, these long-tailed macaques, which elsewhere enjoys an infant survival rate of 80% and a capacity to double its existing population every 4 years, will has to be put on an endangered list soon. My dear viewers, how do you like this video answering some of your queries? It is very time-consuming to make one, but I honestly did enjoy the process of making it. Would you like to see more videos like this one in the future? Please do take the poll by clicking the top right info button. Thank you.